our kids are into this. Remember, this is a time to learn, not to have a good time back there. See that turbo thing going over there? All right, well, we've already had several sermons today. I guess I'm just the last one. Matthew 7, 11 and 12 is the verses for today. This is the deal of the year, the deal of the year. Matthew 7, verses 11 and 12. I'm sure you'll recognize verse 12. You then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children. How much more will your Father who is in heaven give what is good to those who ask him? In everything, therefore, treat people the same way you want them to treat you. For this is the law and the prophets. The golden rule is verse 12. But sometimes we don't understand it in the context which it's given. And it's given to us in the fact that, Jesus was talking about here, giving good things to other people. And I hope that this Christmas season you received a lot of good things from friends and family and loved ones. We don't have a whole lot of farmers in our congregation, but and this was especially for Paul Sands, but he's not here today. But anyway, an Oklahoma farmer, we do have some people who are from nearby Oklahoma, Nebraska, back there. So an Oklahoma farmer had been taken in so many times by a new car dealer. I hope we don't have any new car dealers here. But he wanted, and the new car dealer, he wanted to buy a cow from the farmer. And so the farmer priced the cow this way to the new car dealer. Basic cow, $200. Two-tone exterior, $45. Extra stomach, $75. Product storage compartment, $60. Dispensing unit, four spigots, $10. Genuine cowhide upholstery, $125. Dual horns, $15. Automatic fly swatter, $65. Total, $595. Still a pretty good deal, I think. 1 Timothy 6, verse 10, it says, "For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil." The love of money leads to a lot of evil in our world today, doesn't it? I think sometimes we have too much money, and it gets us in trouble because we buy stuff with it that takes away time we could be giving to the Lord because we have to take care of it. Getting a large sum of money is, you know, often not a good deal. It's not. You know, you probably are familiar with some stories. I'm not going to give you any today because you probably have heard them all, but at least some of them. But, you know, people who win the lottery, it doesn't always turn out real well for them. Sometimes they end up, you know, worse off than before they won the money. So, money is, having a lot of money, it's not really always a good deal. But I got good news for you. I want to tell you today about a really good deal. In fact, it's the deal of the year. And it involves the Lord Jesus Christ and His church and Christianity. In fact, you're sitting right in the middle of it today. You're sitting right in the middle of the best deal there is. One of the reasons that this is the best deal there is because of the power of prayer. It's already been mentioned this morning that, you know, what a privilege it is just to be able to go into God's presence. And one of the songs was about that. The children's moment was about that. Dan addressed it in his prayer time. One evening, six-year-old Bobby asked his father for a puppy. "Sorry, Bobby," his father said, "not now." But if you'll pray really hard for 2 months, perhaps God will send you a baby brother. Well, little Bobby prayed real hard for a month, but nothing happened, and so he quit praying. Isn't that pretty much a description of us? We're praying for something, nothing happens, and so we just quit. We shouldn't do that. We should pray until something happens. Drop that down the wall. Push. Keep pushing. Well, Bobby's mother had a baby. And the little baby arrived at home. He was looking at the baby beside his mother, and his proud daddy pulled back the covers a little bit to expose another baby, twins. And little Bobby said, "Well, I'm sure glad I stopped praying after a month." Well, I don't know that that necessarily had anything to do with Bobby's praying that there was twins, but certainly the power of prayer, as we pray, things happen. And prayer is one of the things that makes being a Christian such a big deal. Because, you know, we could probably go around the room this morning if we had time to do it, and you could probably all tell us something you prayed for that happened as a result of your praying. And we have a Heavenly Father who loves us so much. He's just waiting to hear from His children. Remember what that verse 11 said? "If you then, being evil, know how to give good things to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give what is good to those who ask Him?" God, just waiting to hear from us. Do you believe prayer makes a difference? I said, do you believe prayer makes a difference?
Yes.
Okay. I do too. And so we ought to pray. You may have heard of George Mueller. He was a guy who believed in prayer. He believed in it so much that he wanted to establish an orphanage for homeless children in England. And the first home was a rented home, and this is in 1836. In a matter of days, they had 43 children brought to them to take care of. Mueller and his co-workers decided that the success of their orphanage would not be determined by the amount of money that they were able to have. It would not be determined by the number of children that they took care of. It would be measured by the number of minutes they spent in prayer. They believed the more time they spent in prayer, the more blessings they would receive from God. Let me tell you how that worked out for them. When they first constructed their first building, Mueller and his friends remained true to their conviction to spend time in prayer. In fact, they kept concentrating on prayer until eventually they had 5 buildings to house children in. They had 110 workers. And in those 5 buildings, they had 2,050 orphans they were taken care of. George Mueller not only counted on God to provide, but he believed God would provide abundantly. In 60 years, George Mueller cared for 9,500 and some orphans, and $7,500,000 was given. This is in the 1800s now. And they never once asked for money from anybody. They just prayed for God to provide. And He did. J. Russell Morris, one of our church missionaries, had been on the mission field for a long time before he ever took a furlough. And when he did, he was staying his very first night in the house of some friends. And his gracious host asked him the next morning when he woke up how his night's sleep went. And they were surprised when reluctantly he said, "Well, I was cold all night long, really." And they asked him, "Well, didn't the electric blanket work?" And J. Russell Morris had never seen an electric blanket. He didn't know what it was. He just thought it was just another blanket. But once he knew what it was, he never had another cold night, because he knew how to turn it on and operate it and stay warm. It's that way kind of with prayer and the power that prayer has. It may be that we spend many nights in fret and frustration and discomfort because we've never turned it on. We don't know how to use it. We don't use it. You know, I suggested earlier that we take 15 minutes in 2015 to pray and read your Bible. And if you got the opportunity, take even more than that. Power of prayer is one of the things that makes our faith and our Christianity the deal of the year. Because just think about, we can talk to God. We can have an audience with the most powerful force in the world, that's God. And He not only listens to us, but He can speak to us as well. Another thing that makes our faith and our Christianity the deal of the year is the compassion of the church. Philippians, or 1 Peter 3:8 says, "Finally, all of you live in harmony with one another, be sympathetic, love as brothers, be compassionate and humble." I think there are probably times in life when we seem to be overwhelmed with struggles and problems and difficulties in our life. And we need to be aware of people who are having these struggles and disappointments in life. And we need to seek them out. As a minimum, we need to be sympathetic to them and show them compassion, show them the love of God, and try to explain to them God's truths in a way that they desire to follow them. Compassion and sympathy, if we're Christians, shouldn't that be a big part of our lives? Show compassion and sympathy to other people? I think so. And that's, you know, that's the one thing that Jesus said that they would know we were Christians by our love. How can we not be sympathetic to people who are hurting and show compassion to people who are having problems if you don't love them? Well, if we're Christians, we've got to do that. Whenever Jesus saw hurting people, Matthew 9:36 says, He had compassion on them. And that just wasn't feeling sorry for them, that they were down on their luck and had going through problems and having some sickness or disease. Jesus did something about it. He went to them, He ministered to them, and if He could heal them, He healed them. If He could touch them, He touched them. Galatians 6:2 says, "Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ." Philip Yancey tells a story of a doctor named Paul Brand, who had devoted his life to treating leprosy patients in India. In the course of one of the exams that Dr. Brand did, he put his arm around one of the patients that he was working with. And he was speaking through a translator and telling this patient who he had his arm around what he would be doing to help him and what he would need to be doing as kind of aftercare as he left the doctor's office and those kinds of things. And to his surprise, the man began to shake and just sob. almost uncontrollably. And Brand asked the translator if he'd said something wrong. He said something that offended this person. And the translator, after talking to the person, found out, no, he hadn't said anything wrong. This patient who had had leprosy said, it's been so long since anybody has ever touched me. It just got to his heart. We need to touch people, you know. People desire to be touched. That's a way we can show them that we love them. The compassion of Christ in us is oftentimes evidenced in simply just a touch, a handshake, a hug, a pat on the shoulder. At other times, it has to be a little tougher than that, maybe a little boost on the bottom. But compassion is one of the things that makes us, as Christians, have the deal of the year. And it's a deal we shouldn't just keep to ourselves selfishly. It's a deal that we need to keep spreading and sharing with other people. The compassion of God's people in the church makes what we've got the deal of the year. And it makes other people want what we've got. Another thing that makes what we have the deal of the year is the beauty of baptism. In Romans 6, 3 and 4 it says, do you not know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into His death? We were therefore buried with Him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too might live new life. We go into the baptistry, we go down into the water, and we come up out of the water and live in newness of life. Because there's supposed to be a death that happens down there in that watery grave. So when we come back up out of that water, we're brand new. We have new life. And that's the beauty of baptism. It gives us that picture to hold on to in our minds of that day when we were baptized. When we died to sin. Started our new life in Christ. We believe baptism is important around here, and that's why we have a baptistry in the church building. That's why we immerse people into Christ when they decide that they have sinned and they need to repent. They want Jesus Christ to come into their lives, and they want to live for Him. We believe baptism is important because Jesus must have thought it was important because He Himself was baptized and he had no sin. I think he did it to fulfill all righteousness, the Scripture says, to show us how important He thought it was, so that we too might be considered and be obedient to His command. You know, Jesus Himself said that he that believes and is baptized shall be saved. He must have thought it was pretty important to tell us that. What do you think? On the day of Pentecost, when the church began, about 3,000 people came forward and were baptized by the 12 apostles. Commentator William Barclay says this of baptism. In baptism, a Christian dies and then rises again. As the water closes over him, it is as if he were buried to death. As he emerges again from the water, it is like being resurrected to new life. If that is so, the Christian cannot rise from baptism the same as he went down into the water. Our belief in baptism, what it does for us, cleanses us from our sins, gives us the Holy Spirit, is another part of what makes Christianity the deal of the year. Because you see, it changes us. makes, it changes us from the dirty sinner that we were, the spotless Christian that we are. As we begin to live that new life, then we want to do our very best to stay spotless, remain clean. What makes this deal of the year so special? I think it's this, that it's for all eternity. See, it's not just for today. It's not just for tomorrow or next week, but it's for eternity. Prayer, compassion, baptism prepare us for eternity, a life with God forever. No one gets in the door of heaven without Jesus. Have you got him? You know? I thought Steve was going to ask you a question today about what's the most important gift? What's the most indescribable gift? Is it the Bible or is it Jesus? He must have decided that it was Jesus this morning because he didn't ask the question. 1 Corinthians 2:9 says, "No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him." That's talking about our eternity, folks. It's beyond explanation. And isn't that what Steve was telling us earlier? That we have this indescribable gift, Jesus Christ. How can we ever describe him completely? How can we ever not keep telling people what we know about him? Life is better higher up. That's why we want to go there. You know? Life is better higher up. I mean, it's pretty good right here, isn't it? But it's even better up there. Romans 8:18 says, "I consider that our present sufferings are not worthy to be compared with the glory that will be revealed to us." You know, even our best day on earth will pale in comparison to our worst day in heaven. That's how great heaven's going to be. That's why we need to want to go there. That's why we want to take this deal of the year and make it our own. 2 Corinthians 4:17 says, "For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all." Are the difficulties and the struggles that you're going through today causing your faith to grow? Are they helping you see heaven a little bit clearer? You know, I think maybe the reason we, you know, let me back up just a bit. I think you've probably heard this statement that, you know, where's the gold in those golden years? You know, when you're younger, you think, boy, I can't wait to get old and just enjoy life and retire and enjoy all that free time. We get old and work. It doesn't happen that way, does it? There isn't that much gold in those golden years. It's doctor's visits and pain pills and, you know, anything but the gold. I think we need to remember that sometimes these aches and pains and these things that happen in our older age is just say, boy, it's going to be better up there than it is down here. These aches and pains, you know, they're just helping us see how much better it's going to be up there. They're just making us say, hey, I'm glad I got that deal. But deal of the year. It's the deal of your eternity, too. Sometimes we wonder if life can ever get any better than it is. Well, it can. It can if we have Christ. Christ is the one person who can make things right when everything seems wrong. Christ can make all things better. He is the Son of the living God. He's the one who we pray to. He's the one who shows us what compassion is. He's the one who gave us the picture of baptism to see how much better it is when we go up there. Life is better higher up. He not only is the Savior of the world, but He's the deal maker. Monty Hall always used to say, which door do you want? Door number one or door number two? I've got a deal for you. Well, Jesus Christ is the door. And that's the only door we should choose. Because if we go through that door, we'll be safe and whole for all eternity. Because we chose the deal of the year. The deal of eternity. The deal that is better, higher up. We're going to sing an invitation to end today. And I hope you give us a thought for this deal. You know, I won't say it's a one-time offer, but it does have an expiration date. But I can't tell you when that will be. But I do know Jesus is coming again. When He does, the deal's off. It's over. You can't have it unless you've gotten it before He comes. So if you don't have it, this morning we offer it to you. If you come forward as we stand and sing.